So today we're going to talk a bit more about double quantum dot, things we can do, and then fun things or different science and different physics that arise and show up. So let's recall for a moment. So first of all, this is a design of a quantum double quantum dot. There's not that much science behind it. It's just, it looks like it would, it seems like it would be able to trap two dots next to each other, and it actually does. I mean, you know, it's a bit of a trial and error and how to actually machine it. But on that one, just take it for granted that we are able to trap one electron on each side. Okay, we're able to bring each dot at a very at a single electron level, and we can control the energy potential of each of them independently and play games like that. And again, I'm going to talk about, so essentially the charge sensing on each side works pretty much like the double, like the single dot. So I will not spend that much time on it because essentially a generalization. I will, however, talk about the quantum transport from one side to the other side. And we'll see there's some quite significant difference in the physics of the things. So let me backtrack a little bit to the single dot. Remember I mentioned that if you have only one spin, it behaves like an artificial atom. So that spin can have different excited states. If you apply a magnetic field, you can have spin up, spin down. But you can also have orbital excited states. It can go from an S wave to a P wave, and so on and so forth. And if you remember, I did mention that the energy difference between, or no, the energy scale between having one electron or having two electrons is much bigger than the internal energy of having only one electron. So the energy associated with Zeeman splitting or energy associated with excited states. Okay? So the reason why I'm bringing that up is I'm going to ask you a quick question. Let's say I give you a box and I put, I put just one electron in it. What will the wave function look like? Maybe it's a little too general. If I want to describe it using the wave function, I will have to describe different property of that electron. So there will be different part of my wave function. Can any of you tell me or knows what would be those different parts of the wave function? So spin would be one part, right? It's an electron, so it got spin. There will be another part.
Space,
right? You will have both, yeah, the electron and the space. So you will have the orbitals, in some sense, and the spin associated with it. Now remember, if we use two electrons, there's two fermions. And if you put them in a box, you cannot distinguish them, so two identical fermions. What is happening, or what must happen, if I take the two fermions and switch them around? What will happen to the joint? Between the
nothing.
Wave function. Nothing? Not quite.
They're
fermions, so they will change sign. So, of course, if you change it once and then change it twice, you're supposed to come back. So, essentially, the swamp has an eigenvalue of 1. So, if you just do 1 the swamp, you should have an IU plus or minus of 1. If it's plus 1, it's a boson. If it's minus 1, it's a fermion, and hold the whole fermion statistics arise. But now, the only thing I want to say is that if you have a certain wave function, a wave function for two electrons, then you have some kind of orbital wave function or a spatial wave function, let's call it spatial, and a spin. Okay?
Not necessarily separable,
but for our cases, it kind of is. Let's say to first order perturbation, zeroth order perturbation theory, it is. We'll see actually a little later where it's not really. And we're going to use that to do some control. So what I'm getting at here is if I have two electrons in a certain dot, then spatial-wise, no, it can be, so just the, let's call it phi spatial. Phi space, phi spin. Yeah, that doesn't help too much, eh? Okay. So you can see, so essentially phi space will be essentially left, right, plus or minus, right, left. And if you swap them, you pick up a minus and pick up a plus. So if in your, so take the case, let's call it, this is absolutely not standard notation. Okay, I'm just making it up as I go. So if I go, let's say with a plus, then what kind of spin function do I have to have to keep on fermion statistics?
Singlet state.
I need to have what we call a singlet state. So which means is that the phi plus spin is getting, and then we'll have something like up, down, minus, down, up. So if I flip the boat, I pick up a plus, I pick up a minus, we're all good. Now if I use minus space, so left, right, minus, right, left. So by the way, as a quick question, is there any possible way to build a two-spin wave function so that if you swap them, it gives me a minus sign? The question is, so now I said it's a singlet. Okay, I just gave one example. Is there another possible state, okay, two-spin state, that if I flip those spin one and spin two, I would pick up a minus sign? Don't think too much, there's not. Okay, we'll think a bit more for the next one. So now, if I have the one with, I pick up a minus sign for the state, the space state. So it means that if I, now for the spin part, if I flip the two, it will have to be the same state with a plus. Now, can somebody come up with one? Up, 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 right. Or up, down, plus down, up. Good. So just for the sake of notation, this one here, we call it the singlet. And those three, we call them the triplets. And for notation, this one is T plus, this one is T minus, this one is T0, okay? And that's a fairly standard notation, so we're back on track. Okay, now everybody understands this? Can I erase it? I'll keep on going somewhere else. Okay. Now, do you remember from David Corey's talk, what kind of if I bring two fermions next to each other, what kind of interaction do I get? Not the Coulomb state, the spin interaction. Spin coupling, what does it look like? Sigma C, sigma Z. Sigma Z, sigma C is an approximation when your two spin are very different. Like when you have a carbon spin and a hydrogen spin, or electron spin and the nuclei spin. Actually, you have hyperfine spinning, but whatever. When you have two spin of the similar type. Remember, you said, oh, the interaction looks like this. He said, but if the chemical shift is different enough, then it will approximate to ZZ. It was a Fermi contact, or it's essentially a swap operation. So it's the, I'm looking for the name. The interaction Hamiltonian, that's kind of generic. But when you bring two identical spin with each other, your Hamiltonian is proportional to something like XX plus YY plus ZZ. Okay? And that, if you look at it, it kind of looks like, if you start with a state like this, it's going to make it flip back and forth. Where I want to go with this is the ground state of the Hamiltonian, or the one with lowest energy, lowest energy eigenstate, is the singlet. Okay, so that's why we always say that when we put two spin in the box, the ground state is the singlet. It's because of that interaction.
I'm sorry. Okay. So X. So the first X refers to
shorthand notation. Okay. Because if not, that will give me one. All right. So now where I'm going with this is when you look at the. This essentially, in some sense, explain why the ground state. What I'm getting at is when you have two electrons in one dot, you have the singlet state, and then you have the triplet state that are much higher in energy. Okay, not as high as the third electron, but there's quite a big gap between the two. Very large gap. Okay, so keep that in mind. Why do I say all this now? When you consider two quantum dots like this, you can think of it as two completely independent quantum dots. So if like the voltage on those two gates is so big that the potential barrier between to go from one dot to the next is very large, it will not interact. It will essentially be independent. But you can open that gate so that what your wave function actually looks like, it looks more like a peanut like this. So there is a tunnel coupling between the two dots, so they can interact. It's like they're one big dot. They're still somewhat separated, but they also have some interaction. So they're halfway in between independent and identical box. Okay? So now let's see how we can look at it from a double dot perspective. So I'm going to look at double dot in terms of a quantum transport. So I have a reservoir, first dot, second dot, another reservoir. So I have a certain, remember one reservoir we used to call it the source with a certain voltage on it that gives me electron with a certain energy. Then I have my first dot, then a tunnel coupling behind them, then my second dot, and I have the drain.
Why is this not necessarily exactly the box? Because you're not looking what's inside, you're looking at the current coming in, right?
So we're going to do transport. So remember when we had only one dot, sometimes there could be current if there was a state available, and sometimes there wasn't current if there was no state available. Now we're going to generalize it to two dots. But there's more physics involved. That's why I was talking about the singlet and the triplet and all this. And then, is that answer your question, or there was something else?
Well, I was just wondering, how do we know just off the bat that this is not just the two fermions in our box?
Well, so what I'm going to explain right now, that's how you're going to get it when you do the measurement. So it's a bit of a circular. So take it for granted that we can do it. But from what I'm going to explain to you, you will be able to see some sort of signature when you do experiments because of this. Okay? Actually, maybe if I backtrack a little bit, before I start showing you how it works in a quantum transport kind of way, let me backtrack and explain you the charging part, like when you can get 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 electrons in it. And it's going to actually work exactly like the single dot one. Remember, the more I was pulling down or giving energy to my dot, more electron can fill in, because essentially you give more energy to electron, or you pull down your potential well in some sense, giving higher energy electron to go in. Here we're going to do the same, but it's going to be two-dimensional. So what I'm saying is, if you look at the occupation, you can look as a function of the voltage, say on the right plunger, versus a voltage on the left plunger. If they were completely independent, right, the more you pull your right voltage down, so at some point here you're going to have one electron, let's say. Let's say we start from zero, we're going to have zero electron, then you have one electron. And something else, you're going to have two electron, three electron, and four electron. And then same thing on the other side, one electron, two electron, three electron. So that if you look at sort of any part, actually it's going to look like like a square like this, and so on. So, for example, if you're somewhere in here, it means that my, well, just to make it a little different, somewhere in here, so I have enough energy in my right dot to have at least two electrons, and enough energy in my left dot to have three electrons. They're independent. We don't care. Okay? Well, two here with 0, 1, 2. 0, 1, 2. There's always 2 and 2. Sorry. My bad. Now, because they are not independent, what's going to happen is there's going to be, now if they're not independent, it means that at some point, because of the exchange energy, when you have a dot in at one place, it can hop into the both of them, because it's allowed to hop. You have like the gate is open, and in the charge diagram is going to look something like a little bar like this. So at that part, so let me just draw it and then I'm going to explain it. And then it looks like this. So here what it means is I have at that point here, that's what happened in my double dot. So if I trace the double dot like this, so I have an energy level. So this is the right one, an energy level here that allows an electron to hop on the right dot, but not enough energy for another for the first electron to hop on the left. Okay, what happened here is the other way around. So there's enough energy there, but not there. Okay, what happened at this line there is when the two energy are exactly there. So you can fill one or you can fill the other. Okay, and it turns out that, and that line here is when, you know, so to be fair, at this very corner here is when it's like that. And at the middle there, during the middle, is sort of when they are both under. Okay, so here's the kicker though. The energy, because now they're coupled, the energy to add one electron in the left, in the right dot, when the left dot is empty, is different than the energy you need to add one electron in the right dot if the left dot already has an electron in it. Okay, so in some sense, if we go back to our formula we had before, what we call the chemical potential. Okay, chemical potential, let's say, what we call chemical potential 1, 1, L, is the energy to add one electron, well, let me write it. So this is the energy to add one electron on the left, given that there's one electron on the right, okay? Or you can write, you can see, as opposed to this guy, where this is the energy needed to add an electron on the left, given that the right electron is empty. And because of the J coupling, not a J coupling, sorry, because of the interaction, or you know, the fact that the tunnel coupling is open, you will have, in general, okay? And this is why now there's a certain place where you can only have, where you can have enough energy to have 1, 0 or 0, 1, but not to have 1, 1. Okay? I see a lot of frowning. Robbie.
So is 1, 1 necessarily higher than 1, 0?
Yes.
It doesn't a singlet though lower the state?
A singlet lower the state, but never as much as having only one of them. Okay, because then you have the Coulomb interaction and all this. So now I was sidetracking a little bit, and the reason is because I want you to kind of understand that adding an electron on one side is not just completely independent of what's going on the other side. Okay, there's an interaction there. Sorry, yeah.
That's just due to the exchange force?
Due to the exchange force, the Coulomb interaction. So, I mean, I will not go into all the details of it because we'll be writing Hamiltonian for a while. But yes, interaction has something to do in it, and the Coulomb force. Actually, if I get there, you will see where both of them, where, like, they play a balance with each other. And sometimes the Coulomb is stronger, sometimes the interaction is stronger. Okay. Now, where I want to go in there is I want to show you. And actually, in real life, if you look at a paper, those lines are straight. Okay? Because when you go in real life, when you change a voltage on this gate, it does have an effect on the right side just by capacitance. Okay, so all those guys are actually tilted. Because if you change the voltage, it doesn't only pull down the right, but it pulls down also a little bit the left. But let's not go there. Okay. Now let's say we want to look at transport. And we're going to look at the transport in the around where there's only one in one side, one in the other side, and one in one. Like, we're just going to play with 0 to 2 electrons. So let's start and assume that we have already we have an electron down here. And let's say, for the sake of matter, we have a spin up on that guy. Okay. Now, if I have a state here, so essentially my mu 1-1, so the energy I need on my left dot, on my left electron to actually hop on, given that there's one on the right dot. So right now there's not enough energy. I can bring it down. Mu 1-1, it can hop in. Now the question, at this point, will I see a current? Will I see some transport? There's two no's here. Why?
Well, I mean, it's got nowhere to jump, right? It can't jump into the next.
So, okay, so let me ask you a next question. What will you need to see a current?
You need the one on the right to be the same energy or above as the drain.
So I mean, if you want to see a current, it has to hop on the right, on the left, then hop on the right, and then hop to the right? Okay. So now we know it can hop on the right. Sorry, left. Your right. My left. All right, whatever. All right. So now, what will be the most likely state that those two electrons will have? A singlet, right? Because even though they're a bit separated, there's still some energy, some interaction energy, so the ground state will still be the singlet. How far above will the triplet be? Pretty far. Okay. I'll come back to that question because maybe we don't have perspective right now. But let's say it's going to be higher, right? Because now you need to go into a higher orbital state, in a higher energy orbital state, so it will cost more energy. So this one here was a mu for the singlet, and we'll have like here the mu for the triplet. Okay. So let's say there are a certain way above. What state do I need to access here so I want to transport? The symmetry?
Same with drain.
The same with drain. Okay. So compared to this one, how far or how less energy will the singlet? So essentially now, if I'm a singlet here and I want to transport, I need to, can I access a triplet state? On the right dot. No, that's a conservation rule, right? A singlet can only go to a singlet. Triplet can only go to triplet. In perfect world, we might discuss that a little later. So if I'm a singlet here, I have to access a singlet state there. Okay. Now I'm going to re-ask that question here. I got a certain energy difference between the singlet and the triplet. And that was a singlet and triplet on one electron on each dot. Now if I look at the singlet and triplet on two electrons in each dot, would the separation would be the same? Bigger? Smaller? Will it cost more energy to be Does it cost more energy to be in a triplet in two dots that are far away versus being a triplet in the same dot?
The same dot will have a lot more.
Same dot would cost a lot more energy, right? Because there will be a lot more interaction, right? The interaction Hamiltonian is way stronger than if they're separated. So what I'm saying here is that maybe, I don't know, maybe the singlet 0,2 is where? Is there, and the triplet is just way high, okay? It's super, super high, okay? So now what's going to happen is I can start playing with my left and my right, and at some point I'm going to end up with, let's say, my singlet mu s 0,2. And it's going to transport. Okay. Now let me ask you another question. Actually, what happened is those guys, they're not that far apart. They're very, very close. Especially if you're weakly coupled. If you have a weakly coupled dot, they're very close to each other. And what I mean by this is because we can have a situation at one point where you have your singlet here and your triplet there. Okay. For in this situation here, what I mean is, so you know, there's a certain bias. Let's make it bigger, just for the sake of argument. It's possible to have your singlet and your triplet all within the bias window. Okay. Now I'm going to ask you, for how long? I don't want time, but for how long will I measure current in this situation here? Given that I have a spin up in the right dot, will I measure current forever? Let's assume no decoherence, no relaxation for now, just for the sake of argument.
The energy level of your right one is still the drain energy level?
Sure, yeah. So if it goes to the left, it can transport. If it goes to the right, sorry, it can transport. Now we really have to concentrate what's going on here.
It can only go through the singlet channel.
It can only go through the singlet channel, okay? So the electron that hopped to first zeroth approximation, like the spin of that electron is independent of the other spin. Okay? So essentially what you're saying, there's only two, so if the spin that goes in is up or down, so you will essentially end up with only with a state like this, or with a if you want a singlet, you have to have a certain amplitude, but you have to have, you know, your singlet is, I'm losing my English today. There you go. You have to overlap with this state. Okay? And now the only two states that are really gonna hop in. It's up, or down, up. So what I was getting at is, if you have a spin down that goes there, a spin down is a certain, so the down up has a certain overlap with the singlet, then it will travel. If you have a spin up, will it be able to try to transport? No, because now you form a triplet, and the triplet 0,2, is way higher in energy. Okay? So if you have a spin up, if you have a spin down coming in, you can transport. Well, if you have a spin up, you get stuck. This is what we call, this is a very important concept in double dot. This is called a poly blockade. In a single dot, what we're doing, when we're measuring the current, only when you can add one more, so you have one electron, and you can add a second one, then you have transport, then you have a third one, you have transport. That was called the Coulomb blockade. When I was showing the honeycomb, we call it the Coulomb blockade. But within each honeycomb, you have a poly blockade, which is not forbidden because there's too much charge. It's forbidden because of the spin, and just the fact that we have a wave function that has to be a triplet, or a wave function that has to be symmetric, anti-symmetric, which gave us a negative, or sorry, a symmetric or anti-symmetric spin state.
I'm sorry. So when does it transform?
It will transform. So hence, to answer my question, you will have very minimal transport in this case, because only half the electron will go up, spin down. So essentially, one electron might transport, the other, because it by chance have a spin down. And then the next one, as soon as a spin up go in, it's blocked. So here, in this situation there, you will not have transport. Because
the question is actually, when does it transport? Is it that both of them are on the right?
It will only transport when you can only access the singlet and not the triplet. So in this situation here, it will transport because the electron cannot access a triplet. So the only one that can go in is a spin down. So the electron will go. But as soon as you can access one of the triplet, then it will block. Okay?
Sorry, the question is actually, so is it that when both of the electrons are on the right, will it transport?
No, so if you want to have a transport, okay, I can put one dot on my right. If I want to have a transport, it has to go on the left, then on the right, then to the drain. It has to go through. If it just hop on the right, you will not see it transport because it will go on the right and be stuck there.
You mean the left?
I meant the left. Right and left. Wait, Ravi had the question.
So how many electrons there is transport? And let's say you're going like one electron at a time.
Yeah.
How many electrons do you measure actually coming out of the drain?
So yeah. So at that point there, right? If, for example, if your barrier from your reservoir to your dot is very thick, then you will get like very few electrons, so you will not be able to measure the current. But that's purely an engineering problem. But you have to deal with it because we live in the real world. So what you normally do is you make the tunneling rate from your reservoir to your dot high enough. So it's a very shallow potential barrier. So when it's allowed, you have enough electron that goes through that you can measure. Typically, tens of femtoampere, which is still very, very, very low. But we have the technique, the electrical techniques to measure this.
Well, I was just thinking, like, so the first spin, or sorry, the spin on the right, it apparently has energy that's not high enough to escape a low.
Yeah.
But what the other electron does is actually raises the energy high enough that both electrons leave through the drain.
So, I'm not sure I got you.
Okay, so the electron on the right, it currently has energy that's way too low.
Well, this is just one electron, right? It's just a state where there's one electron here and no electron there.
Right.
Okay? Now what we look at is the energy needed to go there given there's an electron there. And this is the energy needed to go there given that there's an electron there. Okay? Here we're talking in the chemical potential with one electron. Here we're working with chemical potential with two electrons.
Okay, so it's just like
so I think that's what
combined state, right? So that mu, that's like now the combined energy of the two electrons together.
Yeah. Well, actually, the mu, remember the definition. Now the mu, yes, it's not just a combined energy. Mu is the chemical potential. So it's the energy of, is the combined energy of the two electrons versus the energy of the electron alone. So how much energy do I have to provide my second electron so it can go in that state? Okay, so it's the difference in the two energy. And that's what we call a chemical potential. And there's other names also. There's a couple of names for it. But in the quantum dot community, the chemical potential.
Yeah, so I think you actually addressed it. But so you actually do still have a tunneling current even in this polyblock situation.
Yeah, so now as soon as, like, no. If it's polyblocked, okay, look at it. Now if we're in a situation where it's polyblocked, as long as there's a spin down going in, it's going to go through. Because if there's a spin down, it's going to single. But as soon as you have a spin up going in, then it's a triplet.
Right.
Then it's stuck.
Can't it tunnel through?
It could tunnel through the triplet 0-2, right. But the state is way up there.
Okay.
Okay, we could make it. We could, like, if you could put that one way down, it's possible to do it. But we're just going to concentrate over there because I'll show you how we can use this to make some nice measurements. Okay.
Suppose that the source potential is very high. So there's some probability of another electron coming into picture, like in the left side. The nearest 0-2 on the left side is below the left potential. Below the source potential.
If the mu is 0-2 on the left side, so you mean the mu 2-0? Okay.
On the left side, mu 2-1.
Mute. Sure. Okay. Yeah. Fair enough. What?
So then it can transport, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. Then you would you will have a new transport mechanism, and for the same thing when you get to the mu 2-2 and the mu 3-2. Yes. Absolutely. But we're just going to concentrate on the two-electron problem for now. Because we have a double dot, we don't care about two electrons.
Sorry, I'm still just kind of confused by what exactly the block...
Great, that's what I want.
Yeah, well...
Because then it forces you to ask questions and helps people understand.
Yeah, so is the deal that a spin-up electron can't go in because the energy cost would be too high, or... Can a spin-up electron get in?
It can get in, like in this situation here, it can get in on the left.
Okay.
But then it cannot, then if it's a spin-up, then it's a triplet. So what that means is you have a wave function that has the negative component, which is higher in energy.
Right.
So if you want to, so because you have a triplet, and you have spin conservation and orbital conservation, because you know the orbitals are orthogonal, so you cannot go if you don't apply anything. If you don't apply a control, you cannot go from one state to an orthogonal state. Okay, so it means now if it's in spin up, then you're in a triplet state. If you want to tunnel, you have to tunnel to a triplet state, and that triplet state is like way up in the on the roof.
Wait, what has to tunnel to?
The electron, right? The electron, if you want to have transport, the electron has to go to the right, to the left dot, then to the right dot, then to the drain. If you want to create current, that's what you need. Okay?
So basically, once the electron gets in, let's say a spin-up thing gets in the left, then it's just not going to be able to tunnel through to the right because the energy of having the triplet state in the right would be too high to act.
Too high in energy, and that electron doesn't have it.
Okay, cool, thanks.
You got it. Yes?
Okay, one last question. The spin up electron that is sitting in the right dot, if a spin down electron comes and joins it, does that change its energy? The up's energy, if a down comes and joins it.
Well, when you talk about a system of two electrons in the same dot, asking what is the energy of one does not really make sense. Because they're indistinguishable. Okay? Right? So it's just like, essentially what you're asking now is, if I take, let's bring it back to some language we've seen this week. If you have a spin-up, and then I give you a spin down, and you control a singlet. What is the spin of the first particle? Well, you don't know. They are in a singlet, right? They don't have independent properties, but they have a common property.
Okay. So then, what I'm getting at is one of them then leaves the right dot to go to the drain.
Yeah.
Do we know which one left?
No.
And so then when one of them leaves, is the right dot left in a state with an up in it or a state with a down in it? Or it could be left in either.
No, very, very good point. Very good point.
That's what I'm sort of step by step trying to...
Yeah, very good point. The answer is no, we don't know. What's going to be left behind will be either spin up or spin down.
But we don't know.
But then even if it's a spin down, you will still have the Pauli blockade. Because now, it's not going to be blocked with a spin down, but with a spin up. And actually, thank you for reminding me, because I will need that piece for the next part of the thing I want to talk about. which will probably be the last thing I'll be talking about, but at least I will get there. Okay, so first of all, this is, at least in my case, was one of the hardest thing to get in double dots. And then, are you guys, yeah, one last question before I move.
Yeah, so I think when the electron moves, when one of the electron moves up, they actually still remain entangled, unless you do some kind of projective measure.
Well, I mean,
you can't say that the electron left in the hole is whether up or down. It doesn't make sense to talk about.
What's happening now is when it's in the drain, okay, then yeah, it will be entangled, but for one fraction of a picosecond, because then it's just gone. It interacts with the rest, it decoheres, and there you go. So decoherence is a projective measurement, so that's what's going to happen. And your point is true for, that point is actually true when you talk about copper-pair box. Because copper-pair and superconductor, when they tunnel out, they stay coherent. In this case here, they don't, they decohere. Okay? And that scale of decoherence is very, very, very short compared to everything we like. Okay, but that was a valid point. Did everybody understood the question? Right? Okay. Right. So now, why do I spend more time on it? Well, so much time, because first it's important. That's how you figure out the dynamics. But we're going to use this to demonstrate that we can control the spin. Okay. Remember last time I said I will not talk about the control of spin in dots because it's just like an MR. Right, you just you apply an oscillating magnetic field, it's a spin coupled to it, rotates. Well, we saw that. We've done it in the lab. But remember last week when I showed how to measure a single spin of an electron, we needed the Zeeman splitting to be quite large so that it overcomes the temperature broadening of the Fermi C, blah blah blah. What I'm saying is that to be able to do single spin measurement in a single dot, you need magnetic field of about 6 tesla, 5 to 6 tesla. Okay? In NMR, it's easy. But with electrons, 6 tesla, electrons in gallium arsenide especially, because it depends on your material, but in gallium arsenide, at 6 tesla, your electron has a Larmor frequency of about 30 gigahertz. And engineering an AC magnetic field at 30 gigahertz is really, really hard. It's doable, but very hard. And actually, my former group in the Netherlands are trying to do it. This might not be easy. Actually, they do something else called electron dipole resonance. Fortunately, I won't have the time to do it. But now I'm just going to explain how they did it using magnetic field. Okay. So now what we're going to do is we can just engineer on our chip. We're just going to put like a wire. Literally just a metallic wire. I won't go into detail in the engineering of things, but it's a wire. We're going to put AC current through it because it's a wire. It's going to create magnetic field. So the magnetic field that we actually add in the plane, that's the 6 tesla or something, is parallel. So that one's going to create a perpendicular field. So now we're back to the NMR thing. Okay? But now we don't want to use 30 gigahertz because it's hard. We want to go in the megahertz, hundreds of megahertz. And that's why we're going to use 2 dots to do this. Because, and the reason I say that, is I said there was a very small splitting between the triplet and the singlet. But if you turn on to about 400 millitesla, give or take, you know, let's say 500 millitesla, that difference is big enough that we can create spin blockade. Okay? The only thing you really, and also with this is you, because if you look at your triplets, you can also split the triplets with each other. Like if you look at, as a function of the magnetic field, right, the Zeeman energy. And then this one has less energy, has a less least energy. This one has a middle energy. This one has the most energy. Okay, so. And then we just, and at 400 millitesla, you can actually see the difference between the three of them. And now I'm going to explain why we want to do this. So we're going to put our system into a spin blockade. So into something, let me start from there. We're going to put our system in a state like this. So we're going to have a spin up, and you're stuck. Now we want to show if we're able to do coherent rotation. Showing that you can do incoherent rotation is feasible, but you want to have a coherent. It means you want to do Rabi oscillation. And what the protocol is going to be is we're going to bring those guys, those three states, way under. So you have a spin up and a spin up. Okay. Sorry. Spin up and a spin up. Somewhere in there. If we apply a magnetic field and succeed in rotating the spin, then that spin is going to flip, right? And you're going to create a, let's say you're up and up, then you're going to create down and up. And down and up is a superposition of the singlet and the triplet zero. So you're going to create some sort of superposition between that state here and that state there. Okay, so that's given that we send some magnetic field. After that, what we're going to do is going to re-raise it. So we have the singlet here. Re-raise it to this part. It doesn't have to be exactly equal. And now you have some sort of superposition between the two. And in that case, will I have some transport? So the singlet, so the triplet zero. Going to have transport. Because in both ways, I mean, you know, you can imagine if it's going to collapse into one of them and then it's going to transport. But you're in a superposition of being in T0 or in S. If you're in the S1, you're going to transport and go like this. Okay?
But what if you're not getting S? What if you're getting T0 when you're measuring?
Well, you will. So here's the thing. Now you will never get T0 because T0 is a triplet. And if you want to transport a triplet, the energy is way high. So you will really just only measure the singlet part of what you just created.
Okay. Sorry, could you go over it one more time? What your initial state is
It's a polyblockade. So in the way we were thinking here, it's going to be up and up. But according to Miriam's comment, it will be either up and up or down and down. So well, the point is it's going to be parallel. Okay. So it's going to be, it's going to be parallel. Let's just go up and up for simplicity. If I can do a NOT gate, so let's assume now I can literally do just a 180 degree, that's going to go to down and up. And this is equal to the singlet plus the triplet zero. Then when I get into the measurement position, it might collapse there. But you know, this part here will transfer.
So I was asking you can't really guarantee that it's gonna collapse to S.
No, you can't. You can, but if you do a 90 degree, half the time it will. Okay? So essentially, you know, what you will measure, you will just measure that you succeeded in doing it half the time, and the other half of the time you will not know anything. So you will not necessarily have a wrong conclusion. You will just have the right conclusion half the time, and the other half is just thing you throw to the garbage.
So this is what happens when we lift the L levels so that they're... Sorry, I still don't understand what you're doing.
So what we're doing, so let me go a little further. Okay. So this is assuming that we've been able to do a 180 degree. But that doesn't mean it's quantum. You want to show that it's quantum. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to do the same thing over and over again, but as a function of the power you put in. So what I'm saying here we're going to do is you're going to flip the spin to alpha up plus beta.
I'm sorry, I think I understand what's going on now.
Right, but I still want to talk about that. Okay, so now this is equal to alpha up plus beta down up, which is alpha up. Plus beta, beta over square root of 2 if we want to be all correct, but you know. So now if I do that for bigger and bigger power, so if I more and more power, I'm going to start modulating alpha and beta and alpha and beta. And essentially beta, the bigger it is, the more current I'm going to get because the more overlap I am, because this is the state I'm going to create. This will never give me current, but this part here will. So you would be sort of, in some sense, able to plot beta as a function of the power on your that the power or the time that you send the pulse, and then you will see a nice Rabi oscillation, which shows that you actually did something coherent. So that was actually a huge result in it, in the quantum dot community, because in principle it's easy, but it's really hard to implement.
So the x-axis there is some extra
Time or power, but you know, you just a bigger rotation angle, essentially. So let's do it as a angle of rotation.
So when was this?
2005. Okay. Yes. So now, okay, my time is up. I just want to mention that in real life we don't do this. Okay. And well, no, actually we do, but now the problem is. It brings some more problem, because here's the kicker, is because there's a random, there's always, so it's gallium arsenide. Gallium arsenide is spin 3/2. So there's random fluctuating nuclear field. Okay? And that messed things up. So now essentially what I'm saying is we know it rotates. We don't know which spin rotates. We don't know if it's the right or we don't know if it's the left. Because it's no, and technically we should be able to do it, but there's too much fluctuating magnetic field. So sometimes it's changed the energy. So sometimes the lowest energy I can state is this, sometimes it's that, and we don't know. What we do now, instead, is the one I'm just going to mention it, is we use what we call spin orbit coupling. This is one way, or we use a magnetic field gradient. So spin orbit coupling, so you can imagine, right? I got my dot here. If I start shaking that gate, sending up and down current, you can imagine the wave function going like this. Okay, and there's something called the Rochebaugh and Dresselhaus term, which couple, and then so it's one term. Let's say alpha plus beta. So my sign might be wrong, okay? And one of them is a Rochebaugh, one of them is a Dresselhaus. But essentially what it says is it couple, that's momentum, couple your movement or your orbital with the spin, okay? So now, and that happened in semiconductors because there's a nuclear spin and there's the theory paper is this thick. So what you do is you take your wave function and let's say you just make it wiggle from one side. And because of this coupling between the spin and the momentum, it effectively looked like an oscillating magnetic field. So by controlling electrically, electrical is always easier than magnetic. By controlling electrically, you make the wave function move around, and it looks like an oscillating magnetic field and rotates around it.
Why is electric easier than magnetic?
It just because in electric you just plug a battery, and the magnetic, you have to wind up coils and things like that. And so that's one way. And then the other way, very briefly, is you can, let's say you put a very small micromagnet on the side. So you're going to create a magnetic field gradient, right? The magnetic field here would be less than the magnetic field there. And now if you take that wave function and make it move around, so it's going to be seeing a small magnetic field, a big magnetic field to smaller, too big to small, too big to small. So you just created a oscillating magnetic field again. You can do that, okay? So in some sense, using the spin orbit coupling, now they look at this in nanowire quantum dot, because a indium arsenide nanowire quantum dot, because they have a very large spin orbit coupling. This, by the way, has been done in 2006 in gallium arsenide. And the indium arsenide has been done like 4 months ago. And all of this has all been done in Delft. It just happened to be good.
So why are people using gallium arsenide substrate?
So gallium arsenide, we were using it because there's a long history of it. We understood it a lot. Indium arsenide is a newer material that we don't know much about it.
Why did you change it though?
We changed it because, with gallium arsenide, the spin orbit coupling is not that strong. So the 90 degrees are not very quick. While in indium arsenide, the spin-orbit coupling is about 9 times stronger. Okay, and there's a whole question of mobility of the electron, but I mean, Gadamer's line is still good because it's got other very nice property. For example, because you only have a spin 3/2, the decoherence of the electron is not too bad. In indium arsenide, it's a spin 9/2, so very strong decoherence. Okay, so you know, it's a push and pull. We're still at the investigation of materials and what we can do and how to do it. But yeah, this was in 2006. The whole micromagnet and the oscillating magnetic field was done, I would say 2009, 10, and 11 in Japan from the group of Teruja. Those things, everything like the electrical and the magnetic field was done in the group of Vander Sipen and Delft. And the nanowire quantum dot, Jonathan Baugh here works on it also. And then, you know, that's just a few. Like, there's people looking in silicon germanium quantum dot. There's people looking in carbon nanotube quantum dot. There's, you know, there's a whole whack load. But the whole principle of poly blockade, Coulomb blockade, it all applies.